we go to prayer this morning, the altars are open just like they always are. It doesn't even have to be a Sunday morning. You can come in and pray at the altars. It's nothing. It's just a special place for you to bow before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and spend some time communing with the Savior, the one who made the ultimate sacrifice for each one of us. So let's pray this morning. Lord, we just thank you so much for the assurance that each one of us can have, Lord, to know that it is well with each one of our souls, Lord, because we've trusted in you and we know through your sacrifice that our sins are forgiven and we know that our future is at home in heaven with you. But Lord, right now while we're here on this earth, we're kind of in the trenches. We need to be fighting the battle for you, Lord, spreading your word to those around us. Lord, sharing the hope that you've given each one of us through your son's sacrifice. Lord, we just want to lift up our nation, our world today. You know the chaos that has surrounded each one of us and is surrounding our countries. Just ask that you, Lord, help us to be the example for Christ to each one. And Lord, we just want to lift up those that are hurting and sick. And Lord, we've got so many on our prayer list here. You know each and every situation. And we know that we can trust them to you, Lord. We can trust them for healing either here or in heaven. And we just lay it all in your hands. And we know that you are faithful. And we know the peace that we have through that knowledge. And Lord, we just ask that you be with us this Memorial Day weekend. So many are going to be celebrating and having picnics, and there's also going to be so many that are grieving. And we just ask that you touch those hearts, Lord. Give them hope and peace in the midst of their struggles, Lord, to know that they can trust in you even in times of loss. We just thank you and we praise you, and we just ask that you be with the service today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Well, one of the great mysteries of life, really one of the more vexing realities of life, is why does evil flourish? Why does evil flourish? I mean, we've seen the events of the last week or the last few months. We think about the shooting in Texas this week, and they take place on a regular basis in the city of Chicago and other cities around the country. Ukraine and all the events taking place there in that country. Some of you have followed the Johnny Depp and Amber Heard trial there. And we think, you know, why do people like this, why do they flourish, right? I guess he has like 20 homes around the world and an island, private island somewhere. We think about our government and the things taking place in our own country. We think about runaway inflation. We think about the push for, you know, renewables and all that kind of stuff, electric cars and all that, while the average citizen can barely afford to put gas in their car. Why is it that those in power, those who are wealthy, those who are elite, how is it that they seem to flourish and the rest of us suffer? Well, this is the problem that the writers, even of Scripture, dealt with. Jeremiah 12, verse 1, the prophet asks this: why does the way of the wicked prosper? Why do all who are treacherous thrive? Now, of course, we know that there are many instances where evil don't necessarily prosper, where they don't thrive, or where those things get them into trouble. But it's a question we've long asked, and part of the reason we ask that and we get caught up in that and confused by that question is because we have the wrong perspective. We're taking a short view of things, and if we focus on the wrong things, it can become very discouraging, can it? Watching the news on a regular basis, right? And seeing what's happening in our world can be very discouraging. Well, the psalmist, David, he had a similar experience to us. And he said this in Psalm 73. He says, "Surely God is good to Israel and to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost slipped. I had nearly lost my foothold. For I envied the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked." David is saying, listen, I almost stumbled myself. I was caught up in what was going on. And why did I almost stumble? I almost stumbled because I envied the wicked. I was caught up looking at them and watching their lives and maybe wanting to be with that. And he goes on there in verses 4 through 14, and then he talks about how the evil flourish and how they splurge and how they have so much excess and waste and they grow fat on the, you know, all the things that they take. And so he's wrestling with this question. But then he goes on and he says, how am I supposed to understand this? How do I wrestle with this? How do I grapple with this? And I'm grappling with this. There we go. Oh, it went all the way back. Let's skip ahead. And then he says this in verse 16. When I tried to understand all of this, it troubled me deeply. Right? We feel that, right? We feel that way. Until I entered the sanctuary of God, and then I understood their final destiny. You see, the answer wasn't in himself. The answer wasn't in economics or the philosophies of the world. The answer he found in the sanctuary of God when he went to God for the answer, when he went to his word, when he looked to him for a response. How am I supposed to understand this? He says, I go there, and then I understood their final destiny. We've all heard the phrase, begin with the end in mind, right? It's a good thing to do that, all right? Start with the end in mind. What is my goal? What is the outcome that I hope to have? Well, the good news for you and for me today is twofold. One is to know that no evil deed will eventually go unpunished, okay? So we don't have to live in this world. We don't have to see terrible things like what took place in Texas this last week or elsewhere in our streets on a regular basis and feel like, God, where are you? Why aren't you doing anything? Why do evil people get away with these things? The truth is, their final destiny is that no evil deed will go unpunished. Now, whether that is that Christ, and if somebody who has lived a life of sin and evil at some point put their trust in Jesus Christ, whether or not it's that Christ takes that punishment on himself and is forgiven on the cross, or it is ultimately they themselves are punished for it because they rejected the offer of salvation, one way or another, evil will not go unpunished, right? So if we can begin to have that kind of perspective, it can help us to make sense of our world, to be encouraged. But not only will no evil deed go unpunished, but no good deed done for God and in the name of Christ, built on that foundation, no good deed will go unrewarded. Some of you sitting here this morning, you've served in this church or another church for many, many years. Maybe you've taught Sunday school. Maybe you've been a greeter. Maybe you just shoveled snow out in the parking lot in the wintertime. And sometimes you ask yourself, God, why am I doing this? Does anybody notice? Does anybody see? And I want to tell you this morning, 100% certainty, absolutely yes, your Heavenly Father sees what you have done. And no good deed will not be rewarded. But it's always in God's timing, isn't it? Sin will be judged eventually. Evil will get what's coming to it, again, unless people turn to Christ. But it's in his time. God is withholding judgment until just the right time. And so we can trust in him. So I want to share with you this morning, today, from God's word, what future awaits those of us who have put our faith and trust in Christ with regard to future judgment. Now that word judgment, that's a word that we don't like in our society, isn't it? I mean, you hear people say, oh, you're so judgmental, or Christians are so judgmental, and that word judging, people just really hate that word. But why do they hate that word? I mean, it doesn't make sense to hate the idea or the concept of judging. I mean, if we didn't have judgment in our world that takes place right now through our legal system and law and all of these things, the world would be incredibly unfair, wouldn't it? And we wouldn't have the equality we have. We wouldn't have rewards that we get at school or at work or in our house or the fairness we see around our world. We need judgment. We need to be able to discern. We need to be able to make judgment. We need to be able to decide what's right and what's wrong and then to pass judgment on those things. So we need judgment. This sermon series, we've been exploring what is the Christian's future. We've talked about the coming rapture that's coming. We will be raptured up to be with Christ in heaven. We talked about what it's going to be like when we get to heaven, the Father's house. What he's prepared many rooms for us. What does that look like? We explored that. I encourage you, if you missed it, to go back. You can watch those. We looked at last week about the wedding supper of the Lamb, a wedding that's going to take place between believers and Christ. In other words, a perfect union with us and Christ that's coming. But today we're going to look at future judgment. And make no mistake, judgment awaits everyone. There's not a person here, there's not a person on this earth who will not at one point face judgment. I want to encourage you to take your Bibles, turn to the book of Revelation. We're going to be in chapter 20. There's a pew Bible there in front of you, page 1936. If you want to follow along, I'd encourage you to do that. We're going to be looking at the judgments that are yet to come in the future, and we're going to work backward in these judgments, okay? They're not, all of them aren't specifically chronological, but definitely the first one, the last one is the last one. And the first one we're going to see here in a minute is the first one. The ones in between fall in between those. But we're going to start here in Revelation chapter 20 and beginning at verse 11, if you would listen with me. Let's stand together as we read. Would you do that with me? It says this, and this is the vision that Christ gave to John as he's writing about the end times and about the things that are yet to take place. The end of time, he says this. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. Earth and sky fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. This is the word of God. You may be seated. There is a judgment coming one day called the Great White Throne Judgment. This is the last and final judgment that will take place over all of the earth, over all peoples. There is not a single person who was living at that time who will escape that judgment. Every person will face God. And if their name was not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, in other words, if they hadn't put their faith and trust in Christ, they will face eternal punishment. But those who have put their faith and trust in Christ will face eternity with God. It tells us there, this final judgment that takes place, that everyone is judged according to what they had done. Whether good or evil, they were judged. No one escaped it. And it even tells us that just before this, and this is the second judgment, that even the angels and Satan and death itself will be judged, right? We saw that there verse 14. Death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. And we see in just a few verses before that, in verse 10, Satan and all of the fallen angels, his demons, are judged. Another judgment that takes place before that, then, is the judgment of the tribulation believers. This is the judgment that takes place after the rapture. All believers who are alive today will be raptured up to be with God, but there will be people who will be alive during that tribulation period. That's a 7-year period of judgment where God's wrath is poured out upon the sin of the world. And we looked at that last week a little bit more closely. But there will be people who come to know Christ after the rapture. Whether or not they had grown up in church and they knew the truth, but they weren't living the truth. And so when Jesus came, they were left behind. And then all of a sudden they see, God, you were real. You were coming back. And I wasn't ready. But then they will give their heart and life to God. And there will be many others who come to know him during that time. Well, they will not be judged, which we're going to see at the judgment seat of Christ, but they will be judged a little bit later on during the judgment of the tribulation believers. And they will then be able to say, we believe in Christ, and they will be able to enter into heaven. There's also then the judgment of the Jews. The Jews will face judgment before God for what he has done for them and offered them. We see this in Ezekiel chapter 20, verses 33 through 38. There's also then the judgment of Old Testament believers, right? Those who have lived during the Old Testament times before Christ came. The Bible tells us that God looked at their righteous life and accorded it to them as salvation. So they will then be judged. There's also the judgment of the Gentiles. And this and the next one are really what go together. And this is those of us who are here, is we will be judged at the second coming. Matthew chapter 25 talks more about this. That's our passage, one of our passages I listed for today. You can read that on your own. I'm not going to read it here. But the thing I want to focus on is this last thing, is the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ. This is the Christian's future. This is what awaits us, to be judged before the judgment seat of Christ. Now, I don't know about you, but as you look at this, as we talk about judging, as we begin to even start to imagine what it might possibly be like to stand before the God of heaven, the perfect, all-powerful, all-knowing God, who sees all, who knows all, there's not a single thing we've ever done that we can hide from him. What it must be like to stand there before him, how that might seem like a very frightening thing. And for many people, sadly for most of the world, it will be a terrifying, truly terrifying thing. But the good news is, the wonderful news is, the truly great news is this, that one of the many blessings of trusting Jesus Christ now and in this life is that we will only face one judgment. We will only face the judgment seat of Christ. And let me be very clear about what this judgment is. We're going to explore this. But the judgment seat of Christ is not judgment to determine who gets into heaven, because we're already going to be in heaven when the judgment seat of Christ takes place. The judgment seat of Christ is when believers will receive their rewards for how they lived for Christ in this life. In other words, it's like the reward ceremony. It's like a graduation ceremony, since we're having so many graduations coming up around this time of year. It's like all of that work that you've done, now it is finally recognized before the judgment seat of Christ. The Apostle Paul puts it this way, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10. He says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad." Or as the New Living Translation puts it, "We will each receive whatever we deserve for the good or evil we have done in this earthly body." This is an exciting thing, to get to stand before God and to receive the rewards for the life that we have lived for him. All of those things you have done and the things that have gone unseen, all of the times you have sacrificed, all of the times that you have given beyond what you thought you could give, all the time that you gave, the prayer that you did, all of these things will be rewarded one day before the judgment seat of Christ. Now, let me be very clear. This is not talking about a works salvation. You're not earning your way into heaven. Okay, you're not getting up there and God's going to say, "Well, you've done so much good and so much evil, I'm going to weigh these things, and if the good outweighs the bad, you get into heaven." That's not what I'm saying at all. This is for believers, people who have already put their faith and trust in Christ as their Savior, to receive based upon how they have lived for Christ. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, he says this, "It is by grace that you have been saved, through faith." Right? It's not anything that you've done. It's not from yourselves. It is the gift of God. "Not by works, so that no one can boast." There is nothing you can do to earn salvation. It is the free gift of God. But then he goes on in the next verse and he says this. "We're in Christ now," he says, "but we are God's handiwork." In other words, something God has fashioned us. He's made us. He's created you who you are to be. You're created in Christ Jesus to do what? Good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. We are created for good works. We're saved by grace, but we're designed. we're created. God created us to serve him, to love him, and to love others, and to do good works. Now stop and let that sink in for a minute. You and I created for good works. And we will appear before Christ to be judged, each according to whether we have done them well or poorly. Take a minute and take an honest assessment of yourself right now. Take an honest assessment of your life. If you were right now to be standing before the judgment seat of Christ, what would your grade be? If Christ were to say, welcome to heaven, I've given my life for you, and you'd say, yes, I placed my trust in you, I'm so glad I'm going to be with you for eternity. And then he says to you, let's see what you have done for me while you were on earth. What would your grade be? If Christ were to reward you right now for how you have lived your life as a Christian, would there be a long list of recognitions, or a short one, or none? What would it be for you right now if you stood before him? Summertime is here, and one of the things I love about summertime are going to the fair. Growing up, we always went to the Allen County Fair, and I loved going there and seeing the animals and riding the rides. And one of the things that as you get older, you appreciate more and more is the exhibit halls, right? You get to get in out of the heat and the sun, and you get to just leisurely walk around, and it's free, right? That's the best of all, is to go to these exhibit halls. And inside the exhibit halls are all these things that people have made, right? Crafts that young people have made, and anybody of any age can make them. And also in there are vegetables and flowers that people have grown in their own gardens, and then they bring them to the fair, and they're judged on what they bring. And so that's, you know, what's the quality like, what's the size like, and the color, and maybe even the taste. So there are like even some baking things that they can do. But they're all judged on the type of fruit, if you will, that they produce, right? What they have brought, what they have worked on throughout the summer or throughout the time leading up to the fair. The judge comes along and looks at what they have brought there and judges it accordingly. As Christians, we are called to produce fruit. We are created for good works. We're designed for that. That's what you're made for. Not to live for yourself, not to do your own thing, not to serve yourself. You're created to serve God and to serve and to love others. The list of fruit here is an easy way to gauge whether you are bearing the fruit, whether when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ, what type of rewards you receive. And we see it here in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. He says, the fruit of the Spirit, in other words, the fruit of those who have Christ's Spirit. And when you come to know Christ as your Savior, he sends his Spirit to live in you. Now, grade your life according to this. The fruit of the Spirit is love. Is love one of the most defining characteristics of your life and your interactions with others? It is joy. Are you a person that when people are around you, you express and exude joy? I'm not saying just all the time, but I'm saying that the overall quality and tenor of your life is one of joy. Not always happiness. Bad things happen in life, but you have a joy, a satisfaction in Christ that others recognize and see. Peace. Is your life characterized by peace? Forbearance, that's patience. Are you patient or impatient? Part of the fruit of the Spirit is that he works in your life, the longer you're a believer, and as you surrender more and more to him, he gives you those patience for other people. Patience even with yourself. Kindness, right? Are you a kind person? Are you a gentle person? Is later on, just in a few words here. Goodness, faithfulness. Are you faithful to him? Gentle and self-controlled. If you want to kind of do an early assessment, if you will, a pre-exam of what that's going to be like, it's compare yourself to this list of fruits and see what kind of fruit are you allowing God to develop in your life, or are you suppressing it? Are you allowing him to shape you into who he wants you to be, who he's created you to be? Another way we can know ahead of time is by to know when we stand before him what we're going to be judged on, our actions, is in Matthew chapter 25. In 25 verses 31 to 46 there, it's the parable of the sheep and the goats, right? And you recall this parable. Jesus says there will be two groups standing before him. And one group, he says, have served him faithfully, and the other group has not. And one group will be sent away, and one group will be welcomed into his kingdom. And he says then in verse 40 of Matthew 25, he says, the king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. How we care for others, especially other Christians within the body of Christ, how we care for others is going to be one of the determining factors for the rewards that we receive when we stand before Christ. Whatever you've done unto one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters. One final one, just real quick here, that we can know how we'll be judged is in Matthew chapter 12. Jesus says this, verse 36, I tell you that everyone will have to give account on the day of judgment for every empty word they have spoken. Wow. Did you speak any empty words this week? Did you speak any words that tore somebody down? Did you speak words that maybe weren't as truthful as you know they ought to have been? Did you speak any words in anger and unnecessary anger? Or did you speak words of life, words of hope, words of building up, words of encouragement, words even from God's own word itself, sharing that with somebody else to help build them up and encourage them? Because one day we will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. We who are believers, who are going to be in heaven, but we will be judged based upon how we lived according to the works that God has given for us to live. We will be judged on our fruit, judged on how we serve those who are truly in need, judged upon the words that we've spoken. And the hope and the expectation and the purpose of your life and my life is that we will produce an abundance of good fruit. That's our hope. That's God's goal. You remember the parable of the stewards. The owner of the vineyard went away, or the owner of the, I can't remember if it's a vineyard, but anyway, he goes away and he gives to his stewards, invests in them, gives them so many talents, so much money, and then they're to go out and they're to invest that. And it says that some of them went out and they invested what God had given to them, and it produced an abundance, 30, 50, and 100 times the original investment that the king or the owner or the ruler had made. We are created for that. You're created for an overabundance of production in your life. I'm not talking about producing money. I'm not talking about producing things. I'm talking about producing the fruits of the Spirit in your life. That's what you're created for. And so I want to strongly encourage you to let your life produce good fruit. Not the bad fruit, but so that on that day you can rejoice even more when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Invest in your future, folks. You can start today. Maybe you've wasted a lot of time, but begin now investing in your future. Every day is another day to be productive for the Lord. Amen. Well, the word there in this passage that we read there in 2 Corinthians 5:10, where it is translated for us as the judgment seat of Christ, the Greek word there is the bema seat. This word bema is a Greek word, and it was a word that was used, and Paul is using it on purpose here. This word, this idea of the bema, or the bema seat, was a word that was used in the Greek Olympics, okay? In that region. This is where we get our Olympics today. Came from, you know, from the Greeks, right? So this bema seat was a place where a judge, it was an elevated seat where a judge would sit to observe the events. to observe the athletes in action, right? To see what they had done, maybe so that he or she could see who finished the race at this time or who won this battle or who won this, you know, whatever the things were they did back then. They would be seated on this elevated seat called the Bema seat. It was the seat of judgment. And the Bema was also the same word used for the platform where the athletes would receive their reward. So they would elevate, they would rise up to the Bema where the judge would then grant to them their reward. We've all seen, right, the wreath of leaves, the laurel, be placed upon their head for the victors. It is this Bema seat, the judgment seat of Christ, from which Christ will examine our lives and actions and words accordingly. Now, there's several things I want to note about this judgment that we will face. That's encouraging, I think, to you and to me. The first one is this, and I'm going to go through these quickly because I've got a few more things here at the end I want to really focus in on. But real quickly, the judgment will not be a comparison to others. You and I are not going to be up there and be compared to, you know, Billy Graham and Mother Teresa or whatever these great people we think of, or St. Augustine or Martin Luther or John Wesley, right? You're not going to be compared to them. You are going to be judged each accordingly to what God has invested in you. You alone, judged according to who you were created to be. Not who he created somebody else to be, but who you're created to be, right? So we don't need to go around as believers comparing ourselves to others. We need to be who God has designed us to be. Not only that, but we're not going to be judged on how big or how much we produce, but rather on how faithful we've been, okay? That's great for us pastors because the average size of a congregation in the United States is under 100. So if we were all judged on, if we had mega churches, we would be in hot water, right? We're not judged on how much we produce or how much we make. We're judged on how faithful we have been. Mark 9:35, Jesus says, "If anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and the servant of all." Right? In other words, if you want to be first, if you want to be a place of great reward in heaven, then on this earth, you're going to be in one of the last places. You're going to be in the back. You're going to be serving. You're going to be out of sight. You're not going to be about showing off for others. And that's not to say that some people aren't called to be up front. Obviously, I'm here, and people like Billy Graham and others are in places of God has placed them there for a reason. But they're there to serve. I'm here to serve. So you're not going to be judged on like, well, look at everything that I've done and on all these things that I made and how big of a church I grew or whatever. You're going to be judged on how faithful you've been. Third, Jesus will be the judge. I'm not going to judge you. You're not going to judge each other. Jesus himself is going to be our judge, and he's going to judge without favoritism. He's going to judge fairly, and he's going to judge personally. Galatians 2:6 says that God shows personal favoritism to no one. And Revelation 2:6 says God will give to each according to his deeds. 4 says this, that Jesus Christ will judge according to the truth we've received. Now that's really good news, but it's also a little bit scary. let me explain why. It's good news, especially for those, sometimes you've maybe thought about these people that maybe grew up in a country that's not a Christian country, and they don't have much access to the scripture, or they don't have much access to know much about Christ. They're going to be judged according to what they know, according to the truth that's been revealed to them. But you and I are going to be judged differently than those who don't have much access to the Bible. We're going to be judged because we have had endless access to the Bible. What have we done with that? Finally, we're going to be judged according to our abilities. If God has not given you a certain gift, he's not going to judge you for not using that gift, right? If you're not a singer, he's not going to say to you, "Why didn't you sing, Kurt?" My brother-in-law. We always tease him. He's not going to say, "Kurt, why didn't you sing?" But he's going to judge you according to the gifts that he has given to you and how you've used them for his purposes. If he has given you something, if he expects you then to use it for him. As I was kind of thinking about this and reading through the passages of Scripture and some of the resources I was looking at, I started to think about what will it be like to be before the Bema Seat of Christ, the judgment seat of Christ. I think there's going to be a little bit of trepidation in the sense that maybe like graduation from high school, you graduate, you're there, everybody knows you could have done a little bit better, right? Okay, amen? High school seniors, amen? Everybody knows we could have done a little bit better. Some maybe more than others. But at the same time, we're there and it's an exciting time. It's a celebrative moment because we are, in spite of all those things, we are graduating. And we have done a lot of great things. And we have, you know, made a lot of accomplishments. And so we're there to celebrate those things and to receive the rewards for those. I think it's a little bit like that when we come to the seat of Christ, the judgment seat. He's not going to be focused on the things that you failed to do. And the places where you messed up or you tried but you didn't quite succeed. We're going to be there to celebrate what God has done in your life through Jesus Christ. Amen? That's what we're going to be celebrating. You have been saved. He's saved you. He's loved you enough to save you. You're there. And then the things that we've done, I imagine it's going to be a bit like sitting back. And if you've ever, like you work on your home or you've ever had a big project at work or maybe a big term paper at school and you've completed that and you know you've done a good job. And sometimes you like to maybe read that over or you like to sit and you like to look at the, maybe you've done some landscaping in your yard or you think about the project and you sit with your boss and you talk about how great things went or how great the presentation went. I imagine it's going to be a little bit like that. Sitting with Christ, and as he begins to explain to you, listen, you worked here, and maybe you didn't even know what you were doing. You didn't know what that fruit was going to produce. And then he reveals it to you, and we can celebrate together. He's going to celebrate. You remember how timid you were? Remember when you first thought, I could never do this, and then you began to do that, and it's going to be a celebration of what Jesus Christ has done in your life, and he's done through you as you've been obedient and serving him. I have to imagine that's a bit what it's going to be like for us to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. So then, finally, what are the rewards? What are the actual rewards that you and I are going to receive as believers? First of all, we know, of course, from Scripture, he says, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. There's going to be treasure in heaven. We're going to have rewards there in heaven. But even more than those rewards, whatever they might be, Scripture doesn't give a lot of detail on a lot of these things. But it does give specific detail about five types of crowns that we can receive for faithful service to the Lord. Five crowns we will receive from Christ in heaven. First one is this. We will receive, Scripture tells us, the crown of life. In other words, a crown for a life well lived in the Lord. Have you been faithful? Have you served him? Have you honored him? We will receive a crown for that. It says in James 1, chapter 1, verse 12, blessed is the one who perseveres under trial. Having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. Listen, it's all worth it. All the trials you go through, all the difficult things you go through, all the junk that life throws at you, all the terrible things that other people have done around you and maybe even to you. If you endure, if you press on, if you push through the best you can with Christ's strength, with his help, you will receive a crown of life, Jesus tells us, God's word tells us. Another crown we receive is next the crown of righteousness. The crown of righteousness. This is a crown for those who have faithfully lived and waited and lived expectantly for Christ's return. Apostle Paul writes in 2 Timothy 4:8, now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Are you living for the future, for future in Christ? Or are you living for the present? Jesus says, for all those who have longed for him, who have lived for him, who have looked forward to him, who have lived faithfully before him, will receive the crown of righteousness. The next one is this. We will receive a crown of glory. The crown of glory. This is a specific crown. This is one I really like. This is a crown specifically for those who shepherd or lead God's people. That's pastors, that's leaders, that's teachers. Peter writes this. He exhorts people. He says, be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them. Not because you must, in other words, not because you're compelled to or forced to, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not pursuing dishonest gain. In other words, not doing it just for money, not doing it to enrich yourself, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, that's Jesus Christ, that's when he returns, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. In the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders. All of you clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud. I don't think I'm supposed to put that in there. But anyway, it's this that I'm focusing on. When we shepherd well, we will receive a crown of glory. The next crown we receive is an imperishable crown. An imperishable crown. This is a crown for those who faithfully endure trials. Think of the martyrs throughout history. I just watched with Oscar this last week a movie based off of a book called Silence by Shizuko Endo. It's a book that's written about and a movie based upon Christians living in feudal Japan in the 1600s. And there were hundreds of thousands of Christians in Japan. The church had gone in there and done great work, and many hundreds of thousands had come to know Christ. But in the 1600s, Japanese rulers decided they didn't like people serving a Christian God, a God from the West, and so they determined to stamp it out. And the way they stamped it out, as you can imagine, is through cruel inhumanity and torture. And just watching the scenes of these Christians, there's one scene where they're trying to get the these Christians who have been captured to apostatize. In other words, to renounce their belief in Christ. And if they don't do it, they're going to be killed. And so the way that they're killed is they're put on a cross. And this cross is carried out at low tide into this where the water begins to come up. And then they're strapped there on a cross. And over the course of the day, the water begins to come in, and all of a sudden you see that water, it's up to their chest, and then it's to their neck, and then it keeps washing over their face. And it says that one of them lasted for 4 days. An imperishable crown for those who are faithful to the trials of life. It says this, do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? He says, run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. An imperishable crown. If you endure the trials of this life, if you're faithful to Christ to the end, if you don't deny him in this life. Kids, I mean, at school, it's hard to be a Christian. I know that. To be made fun of, to be mocked, to be called racist, or to be called, you know, a bigot or a judgmental. But if you live faithfully for him, you're living, you know you're living faithfully for him, you will receive a crown, an imperishable crown, one day. Finally, this, we receive, one of the crowns mentioned is a crown of rejoicing. This is such a beautiful crown. This is a crown for winning people to Jesus. Your life, the life you live, the things that you've done, the classes that you've taught, the neighbors that you talked to, the kids that you drove to school, all of these things will go into making up this crown of rejoicing, a crown for winning people to the Lord. Paul writes this, for what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ when he comes? He says, what is that? What is that crown? Is it not you? In other words, our crown of glory is you. When you stand before God one day, when you too are standing there with us before the Bema seat of Christ, part of our glory, this crown of rejoicing, is going to be rejoicing seeing you there. Part of my rejoicing, seeing you there, seeing young people there, seeing people that I've had an impact in my life. And each one of you, in the ways that you serve, parents, if you've raised your children, and I know people, children make their own decisions, but you've invested in them. Sunday school teachers, children's workers, it might seem like every week, like, why do I even show up here? Because it's nothing but chaos, or kids don't show up, or whatever. Why am I here? You're investing, and if you're investing in one life, and that life goes on to know Christ as their Savior, and they're standing there, you're going to receive a crown of rejoicing. You've sacrificed, and you've given, and all that you've done to see people come to know Christ, you will receive a crown of rejoicing. And isn't it worth it to work toward those crowns? Let me encourage you to do that. David Jeremiah puts it this way. He says, at the Bema seat of Christ, earthly wreaths and trophies and newspaper clippings and Super Bowl rings and Nobel Prizes, all of those things will be long forgotten. They will be no more. And they will be no more important than combing your hair or checking the mailbox. But what we do for eternity will count forever. What we do for eternity counts forever. What you do in this life, what you do as a follower of Christ, how you serve Him, how you honor Him, how you care for others and love others, how you speak to others, all of these things that you do are a part of getting this crown that He will one day give to you as you stand before the Bema seat of Christ. Revelation chapter 4 describes a scene. This is the coolest thing of all, I think, in regards to this. It describes a scene in heaven where those who are gathered before God's throne come before Him one at a time. And in an act of worship, it says there that they cast their crowns before Him. The crowns that you've earned in this life, the crowns that you've earned for honoring Him and living for Him and being faithful to Him, we're going to get to go before the Son of God and present them to Him. It's all because of you. You made it possible. And we honor them and we lay Him before Him. And like the old hymn says, lost in wonder, love, and praise. That's our reward. That's what awaits you, Christian. That's what awaits me. If we live for Him, if we're faithful to Him, we'll get to stand before Him and honor Him and return to Him what is rightfully His. I think it's fitting that this is Memorial Day weekend, right? When we remember those who have gone, those who have died, particularly those that have served, again, as we've said, and protected our country. One day, when this life is over, when your life is ended, and we stand before Christ, just in the same way we celebrate the faithful service of our servicemen and women, one day, future judgment awaits when we will celebrate the life that we've lived for Him. I'm looking forward to it, aren't you? Would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, it's kind of a humbling moment, and I really wanted this to be a celebrative message, but God, it just feels so heavy because it's just so real, and it's just so powerful, and it's just so truthful. And God, we don't want to take it for granted. We go through the motions so often. We just barely show up. But God, that's not how we want to live. We want to live in such a way that you are honored, you are glorified, you are lifted up, that we become who you've created us to be, the good works you've called us to do. God, that's what we want to do. God, we want to do that so that we will receive rewards one day and the crowns one day. And God, then we can return them and give them back to you in wonder and praise and love and adoration. And we'll understand that it will all be worth it, that everything we've been through was all worth it. That moment we kneel before you. I pray, God, that you would place that in the heart of each one here this morning, that it would just burn deeply in their heart like a firebrand, like a coal that's there that cannot be quenched, cannot be put out. And from this day forward, God, regardless of how we lived in the past, Lord, that we would live for you, sold out to you, serving you and honoring you and loving you and others as you've called us to do. And God, then I pray that as we do that, God, that will spill out into our lives, that will spill over into other people and touch other people's lives. It will expand in this church, and this church will continue to grow to be who you've called us to be. God, we're looking forward to that with all of our heart and with all of our strength. So God, that's my prayer this morning. May that image, that vision of the Bema seat of Christ, the judgment seat, all believers standing before him, celebrating what you have done. God, may that be at the forefront of our vision for the remainder of our lives here on this earth, we pray. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Wow. Whew. Who knew God's word could be so amazing? It is. Well, hey, thank you so much for being here. Let me encourage you to stop by our Christmas tree table out there. The idea there is to bless the Herndon family, our missionary family. And if you know anything about missionaries in the Church of Nazarene, you know they're not getting rich. We want to bless them and their family with some gifts. And so you can stop there, talk to Sue and the NMI team, and we'd love you to do that. And have a great Memorial Day weekend. And pause, will you, tomorrow to remember those who've given their lives for your freedom and then live faithfully according to that. Thanks so much for being here. You're dismissed. Go in his name.